wanted to integrate the family safety units and the early intervention hub to form a domestic abuse hub in which we interventions are delivered, commissioned and signposted. And again, one of the reasons for wanting to do that was about having services which are available not just to work domestic abuse where children are present, but also so that men and women who are affected by domestic abuse can access those services as well. So it's not just a children's services response. We wanted to confirm the service specification for the domestic abuse hub, establish a multi-agency task and finish group or an operational group for the co-production and implementation of the domestic abuse strategy so it becomes more coherent and establish the effective governance arrangements in relation to that. Then going into January to March 2020 to continue the review of the MARAP process to ensure there is effective risk management and oversight of MARAP plans. Review the current training offer. So we do have multi-agency training in relation to domestic abuse, but we felt that it would need a tiered approach. So depending on where you and how you work with families, the training offer needs to match the complexity of the risk that we work with. For human commission services in relation to the programmes which respond to domestic abuse and particularly review the perpetrator pathway and establish the commissioning approach for an evidence-based perpetrator programme. There is an issue throughout the country, not just in the Wirral around how we respond to perpetrators of domestic abuse, and that's something that we need to look into. It's not a quick fix response. You're not looking at 6-week programmes or 12-week programmes, you're looking at programmes that take run over many months and to require people that facilitate those to be trained in terms of understanding the complexity. And then we also wanted to establish the relevant data sets to measure the impact. And then going forward, we wanted to brand and launch the domestic abuse hub and the multi-agency strategy with some of the outcomes. And I've just outlined again on page 7 some of the things that we felt or I probably need to be included in that strategy when we start that piece of work.
Thank you very much. I'm sure you're happy to take questions up on it, thank you. I've got a couple, and I think others will have some too. Well, it's probably more pointed to me because we've asked for a report, a more in-depth report on what's been done to tackle domestic violence, to reduce the incidence of domestic violence, and to mitigate against the impact of it on victims who are already been identified. And we've been asking for that for quite some time, and we haven't had it. What we've had have been the performance indicators, which have given us cause for more concern. So it's good to have this report, and I thank you for it. And I'm pleased to see that you're developing a strategy which you intend to bring about reduction in the overall incidence and impact of domestic violence. There are some things I'd like to point to and be concerned. One is that horrifying statistic, really, that 85% of victims have sought help 5 times on average from professionals in the year before they get effective help. That to me is quite an extraordinary statistic. So if you could address why that 5 times from far away the majority of people who are victims of domestic violence. Why, if 5 times they've had contact with a professional and still become victims, there's still action needs to be taken at the end of it? That's one point. The other point is the limited access to the perpetrator programme. And I have to say, and it may be a national thing, I don't know, it's probably explained to me, but individuals seeking support have to self-fund themselves out of the programme unless it's by the order of a court. And I would guess, and it would only be a guess, that those people who are being asked to take part in that programme by order of a court are probably going to be the least responsive to it, and the ones who probably will be the most responsive are the ones who self-refer, and yet they've got to fund themselves, which, you know. There's 2 points I want to make. I'm sure others have got other points to make. Anybody? Yes?
Thank you, Chair, and thank you for this report. I'm fully aware this is the same report that went to children and families, so therefore it is a very children-orientated report, not one that's related specifically to adults. to adults who don't have children. This is very focused on what happens to children. I'm really concerned about that. Domestic abuse happens to adults. It impacts on children, but it happens to adults. So at the moment, this is all sitting within children's services. Why are adults not part of this? And I'd be interested to see the your views on that. I think there are concerns. This comes in through the interaction front door for children's, but we don't see that for adults. And there's a real danger in my book that adults will be adults who are very vulnerable either because of mental health issues or learning disabilities or physical disabilities, who have the potential to fall through the net. I'm remain to be convinced that at present the service is actually sitting in the right place. I'm very pleased that one of the first tasks is about setting up a multi-agency task and finishing with co-production, because I think unless we do this in terms of co-production, it's whatever we do to reorganise this, it's destined to fail. I am pleased to see that there's recognition of the problems that we currently have, but I would certainly want to know more about how are we incorporating adults. This is the Adult Scrutiny Committee, and whilst this is an interesting report, this is a report about children.
I think in relation to the co-trace programme, I think it is a national issue in terms of, you know, it is difficult to access perpetrator programmes. I think there are some individuals that would want to pay for it. There's no suggestion that they should have to pay for it. I think the point in the report is that even if they wanted to, there isn't necessarily that provision. But what we would want to do would be to commission perpetrator programmes that people could access. And the court ordered ones that if you're convicted of an offence, then you would access the programme by the probation service. So that, I don't know for that, because the...
I did understand that. It was more a comment that that's not really, sorry, it's not really the most appropriate way to actually prevent people from becoming abusers.
Access to a perpetrator programme. I think in relation to the number of times that people contact professionals in terms of their access and support, I think it's about probably links into the training that we need to develop so that people understand that if someone just disclosed domestic abuse, about, you know, what the response can be in relation to that. And then I think it's about having those services that mean that just because you then disclose domestic abuse doesn't mean you necessarily need to refer into children's services or into adult services. I think in relation to the referrals for adults, then certainly the police do refer to adult social care. But I think I was speaking yesterday to managers in adult services around that response in terms of if they have a high referral, of course, and from the police will call VPRF. But I think what happens is quite often they respond in terms of the mental health or the substance misuse issue as opposed to the domestic abuse issue. And I think, again, that probably links into some training around how they can effectively respond in relation to when they get those referrals from the police. I don't know whether... In terms of the response for victims of domestic abuse where there aren't children, I do think it is about, you know, what is it that we include in the strategy, in the multi-agency strategy that enables people to be quite clear about what their response to domestic abuse should be. Because it is, you know, it is a children's report, and that's all I can account for from a children's services perspective. But I think that, you know, if we can have an operational group, a multi-agency operational group, then it's about asking them for their commitment to respond to the issue.
The development strategy has to be adults, children's, whole family consideration and involve all partners in the production of that strategy.
Can I just come back on that? Yeah, thank you for that. whether where things are sitting at the moment is in the right place, and hopefully that will be something that should be considered by both adults and children's services about how we deal with that.
Thank you, Chair,
and
it relates to Councillor Nolan's points as well. I just wanted to add a little to Wendy's response on that, in that the adult services are absolutely focused on supporting people who are victims of domestic violence too, and they do apply the Care Act and Mental Health Act and substance misuse support, but if you also look at domestic violence and link people to available sources of support. However, we haven't got it as right as it can be, and we're absolutely committed to working with children's services to join this up and to improve our offers to people. But I would like to give committee members the assurance that adults teams, they are trained, they do attend the MARAC meetings, they do apply the processes, and it is a priority, but there's more we can do, so we welcome the opportunity to work with them.
I think it sounds like maybe there's slightly conflicting messages. You mentioned around training being a key piece for people understanding how to then handle cases, but you mentioned then, Jason, that people are trained and there's more we can do. So I'm just trying to understand, in your January to March plans, it's a review current training office. I'd like to understand what the current training is, and then is it the training that's at kind of where there's a gap? And if so, if you're reviewing it until March, then what's the plan to then book? Because I imagine it'll be reviewed, then a plan, and then probably gathering training providers and implementation. So it sounds like it could be a potential long time. And if it's not just training, what else are the what are the other gaps? I've got another question, but just that one first. That's okay.
I mean, again, I think it comes back to the right partners around the table in terms of being very focused on understanding what training is being offered, so what is the training that we're offering from the multi-agency safeguarding arrangements, what is it the training that adults are offering, what is it that involved Northwest are offering, what is it that Tomorrow's Women, and I'm not sure that we particularly understand that fully at this time in order to say this is where the gaps are in training, and I think that's where we, I think unfortunately that's where we're at in terms of the strategic response really, is that we're not as far on as we would want it to be. And I think it's about having the key people around the table to be very honest and very clear about what is it that is happening now and what are the gaps for those organisations. And then we can then start to develop a training strategy that sits alongside the whole overarching domestic abuse strategy.
So who will be responsible for overseeing all of the different training strategies being put together, and then who decides which is the best or which is the ultimate training strategy, and then what influence do you have in terms of encouraging that training strategy to then be pushed out through all, because it sounds quite complex, lots of different people around the table will say, no, this is ours, how do you then coordinate but then also improve them all in the same direction?
I think it is complex, that domestic abuse is complex, full stop. And I think one of the things that is referred to is about having those governance arrangements. So at the moment, there's a domestic abuse committee, that's overseeing the pledges. So actually, will that committee continue? Is that what the operational group that's working on the gaps in training, and what training should look like, and what the response should look like, and what the commissions should look like? Is that what the governance arrangement should be? And I think that's what we need clarity of in terms of actually looking across the cups, in terms of actually, this is what the training is, but then as we roll that out further into those organisations, that we can use that committee in order to challenge organisations in order to kind of move that forward.
And who answers that? The questions that you posed there, who answers those questions? So you said we need clarity, and will these structures be in place, and will this governance who says yes or no?
And that would be the multi-agency safeguarding arrangements, so the partnership for safeguarding for children and adults.
And when will this committee then hear back about those structures and those conversations that happen and the decisions that are taken there?
So those arrangements exist, So we really need to just do the review, take it to them and have the decision made and then hold out from the agency.
And let's say, when is that happening?
It's due to be, sorry, on the timeline.
It's in the, I believe it's in the end of March as a review.
So by the end of March, we would want to get an agreement from those governing groups.
So then after March, you'll come back with and here's the structure, here's the decision, and all of those different pieces you mentioned around the consistency of training, the best quality of training, will that all come, that'll all be decided as of March then, is that what you mean?
Yes, that will come and be rolled out across the agencies, that's the plan.
Just a quick point, you talked there about multi-agency safeguarding arrangements. You are clear, I take it, that statutory responsibility for domestic abuse was the adult safeguarding board, not the children's multi-agency safeguarding arrangements.
Councillor Bird.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the report. This is it's very thorough. Addressing a very complex issue. I was absolutely amazed at the scale of the problem in the Wirral. Around double the sort of recommended rate, much higher than other places, 1,000 referrals a year to the family support unit. This is like an epidemic. If it was one incident on one day, it would be a major incident. We'd have a Gold Command meeting, we'd have like all the resources applied to addressing this problem in the short term and also in the long term recovery programme. I'm glad to hear that some resources are aligning in that way. I was also interested in the risk factors for domestic abuse and whether you knew whether if somebody had been in the armed forces, if that was a risk factor. A lot of domestic abuse is about power and control, which is very much at the heart of the military.
It has no kind of social boundaries. You know, I think there will be one in four women affected by domestic abuse. There are partners of serving military personnel, as there are one in six men that are reported to be victims of domestic abuse that will also be in the armed forces as well. I'm not sure that being in the armed forces is any more a risk indicator for domestic abuse than it would be for any other part of
the society. Thanks, Chair. I'm hearing what you're saying, and I appreciate the reports are really doing, but if it is very long, we talk about multi-agency working, it's the multi-agency understanding of across the board. So the least understanding agency would be the lowest common denominator, which sets the standard of response. And one thing that jumps off the page to me is with 95% of police incidents are silver and bronze, 5% is gold, which are most serious. But then, as Moira alluded to, people have asked for help 5 times. So it just jumps off the page to me. That is just a huge gap. And I'm not experiencing this at all, but that's something that absolutely, it's flashing off the bench to me, and that's actually quite basic, and that is incredibly alarming, to be honest. But thank you for your report.
And I think that's one of the reasons for wanting to develop the domestic abuse hub. It's about having some work that people who are living with domestic abuse, be that as a victim or as a perpetrator, that there is a single point of access that they can go to without having to have a referral by adult social power, have been reported to the police, that actually if they want to walk in and say, can I have some advice? And one of the things that was suggested in the strategy is that actually if you're in a relationship where domestic abuse is a factor, but you want to remain in that relationship, that actually we work with that family in order to remain, to sustain that family and to stay safe. And that shouldn't necessarily mean that you need a referral to adult social care or to children's in order to access that service, but there should be a point of access that you can go to.
I think Sharon, you wanted to say something. Sam, you want to go back again? No, Sharon.
Thanks, Sharon. You talked before about within the strategy, the signing up to the whole, from the other organisations. So far,
around the strategy. On a personal level, that's a piece of work that I've only just picked up. So that's something that I will be sort of taking forward, really, in relation to the work that we've started since November around the multi-agency domestic abuse meetings in order to rationalise some of the processes and become more effective around risk management. There's good guiding on that in terms in that in relation to all the statutory agencies, police, health, adults and children's education. So in terms of people are ready and willing to kind of want to make provision and changes around domestic abuse. But in terms of the strategy, it's a very new piece of work following on from the pledges.
Services and to consider future reporting on progress in 3 monthly intervals.